Hi everybody. So, two shocking losses for Federer in the past week or so. First in Indian Wells final, where he should never have lost. He had three match points, you know, 40-15 up. Just like he had those match points with Djokovic in US Open 2011. So, that loss, and then again in Miami second round, I mean, nobody expected him to lose, but again. So let us just try to analyze, you know, what might have caused these losses for Federer and his decision to not play on clay. Is it a good one? Is it a bad one? And what might be the reasons for that decision to be taken in this way? Was that a result of you know, his performance in Indian Wells and Miami, or what was it? So firstly, I think the losses in itself were pretty hard for Roger to take. And after such a good start to the season, you know, winning the Australian Open and then again coming off of a victory in Rotterdam, then skipping Dubai to rest his body, he was fresh in Indian Wells, I would say, and you know, he started off well. But I think as the tournament progressed, you could see against the match against Choric, he was not able to, you know, perform at his best. He suffered multiple breaks of serves in the final set. He was, and in the second set he was a breakdown a lot of times. So there you could see that, you know, he was not feeling the ball well, and maybe tired a bit, or maybe not, you know, in, we can say, in the 100% concentration mode. So that might be a reason for his losses. And then again against Del Potro as well, I think he was playing well only in parts. He was again missing the ball a lot of times. There were a lot of shots, a lot of chances for him, you know, wherein he tried to take the ball early, tried to hit a good return, a winner return, but you know, it didn't work. And then when he tried to, you know, sort of play a rally sort of shot, then of course, if you give your backhand to Del Potro, you know, in the middle of the court, Del Potro was really playing well. And you have to give the credit to Del Potro, because he was playing actually, I think, very, very aggressive tennis, and he served well as well. The only, I would say, the opportunity for Federer came when he, you know, won the first, won the second set somehow in the tiebreak, and, you know, in the third set, in the beginning of the third set, I think Federer had a lot of chances wherein even if he would have stayed in the rally or, you know, sliced the ball down the line, cross court, just kept Del Potro moving a little bit, without trying to play a very you know, difficult or low percentage shot, that would have been enough to for him to get a break. And once he would have got a, you know, got a break in the third set, Federer would have been able to complete the match easily. But that didn't happen. You know, Federer was, I don't know why, but in the third set, in the beginning, Federer was struggling with his own shot making, and he was missing a lot of balls. And actually, gradually, Del Potro settled down, you know, after losing that second set. And once it was 2-all, 3-all, then I think it was more in favor of Del Potro, because I think throughout the match he was playing well. But you know, again at the business end, I mean 4-5-4 and 40-15, definitely Federer should have won that match there. But again, you know, in hindsight, if you see, Federer can argue that, you know, throughout the match Del Potro was a better player and he deserved to win the match. That is completely true, and I think everybody agrees with that. But the only thing that, you know, if you have 40-15 advantage, you just cannot lose from there. And in his previous years, I mean, Federer was, you could count on Federer that, you know, he would never lose that kind of a match. But you know, history has showed that sometimes Federer does lose those kind of matches. I mean, there are numerous examples. When you know, Federer has lost the set when he's 5-1 up, specifically against Nadal, but also against other players. I remember a match in Toronto in, I think, 2010 or 2011. There also Federer was 5-1 ahead and he lost that set. And again in Wimbledon against Tsonga, he was 2 sets to love up, then he lost 3 sets in a row. So there have been some kind of matches wherein, you know, again against Simon in 2011 Australian Open, he was, I think, ahead 2 sets to love, and then again he lost 2 sets. So there have been times in Federer's career, you know, where probably, and you know, perhaps more often than not later in his career, when he has actually lost after having a lead. and it has happened against Nadal numerous amount of times, you know. But we can say that okay, he has that because of that head-to-head rivalry and everything, the Nadal factor. He probably loses those matches, but he has also done that against a lot of other players, you know, Djokovic and the likes of few other players as well, where you know he was ahead in the matches and he had match points, but then again, you know, he was not able to convert on those. So in his previous years, you know, in 2007, 2006, when Federer even had one match point, you know, people could count on him that, you know, he would definitely, if it is on his serve, definitely he would be making the first serve, he would be hitting the winners. But I think, you know, unfortunately, it's not the case right now. I think the part of reason for that is maybe his confidence is not up to the mark right now, which should not be the case because, you know, he's coming off of a perfect season. He has started the season in a perfect way. He's 17-love up. He was 17-0 in for this season. He started off well in Indian Wells as well, and he nearly made it. He nearly won the Indian Wells even though he was not playing well, and that's the mark of a confident player. You always see Nadal doing that, you know, whenever he's not playing well, he ends up winning the tournament. So that is definitely something which we can admire about Nadal. But even Federer used to have that quality. Right now, I would say perhaps he's lacking confidence in his shot making. Probably, as he himself said after in the interview after the loss in Miami, that you know he was not feeling well with the movement. He was not moving well, and when you are not moving well, you cannot compete well in a rally sort of a point. If your serve is not working, if you are not comfortable in your movement, then basically you are exposing your serve, you know, to the opponent. And even as good as Federer's serve is, you know, there will be one or two games in the whole match that, you know, he won't be finding his first serves and he would need his ground strokes to make him, you know, come through those games. But it didn't happen in Miami, it didn't happen in Indian Wells and, you know, the latter stages of the match. And that actually cost him both these matches. Now, I think apart from the mental factor and, you know, the confidence that he had earlier, of course his movement was not up to the level that we have seen. Even in Australian Open, I don't think he was moving as fast as he has always had, but I think still he was moving pretty well. But if you compare him to last year's Miami and last year's Indian Wells, I think Federer was moving really well and he was actually content to, you know, play more rally game. If you see his match against Kyrgios and against a bunch of other guys, he played a lot of matches, you know, where he had to play really well, where he had to grind those matches and win those, you know, through his ground strokes. So that was not the case this time, and I think he needs to sort of, as he himself has said, that, you know, he will be having a very rigorous training schedule ahead of Wimbledon, and that is a good sign that, you know, he knows what he has to do in terms of his physical abilities. And mentally, I think he needs to just reflect on why, you know, he was, I mean, of course, he needs to get over it, and he has already, I think he told that, you know, he's over it, over those losses to Del Potro and even his Miami loss. But I think he needs to reflect for some time, you know, why actually is it happening that, you know, for multiple times he has lost the match points against, you know, Djokovic or any other player for that matter. So once you are in a lead, I think when he's confident, you can just compare his game when he's actually down in a match and when he's up in a match. When he's, you know, say 5-1 up or 5-2 up in a set, you can see his game. He just plays perfect tennis, and the same is the case when he's down because he has nothing to lose at that point. So again, he plays well. It's only the time, you know, when it is 5-all or 6-all or it's a tie break, and when his serve is not working, then his ground strokes are actually exposed. And I think in terms of ground strokes, maybe he's lacking the confidence, and the proof of that is his shot making or his shot selection maybe, because sometimes, you know, he's maybe afraid, as you saw in Indian Wells, you know, final, that he was not playing as many down the line backhands as he used to in the last year or previously against Nadal. he always used to play one cross court backhand and then one down the line backhand in order to, you know, avoid that cross court to cross court rally. But if you see against Del Potro was consistently hitting the balls to his backhand, and Federer was just not able to, you know, change that pattern of play. He should have gone more to the down the line backhand, even though he was not confident. He could have at least tried, hitting so that, you know, he could at least get the form back. Or probably a safer shot would have been the slice down the line, because earlier, if you see his matches in US Open, you know, 2005, 2006 on the hard courts, he used a lot of that shot, the slices down the line, you know, just to make his opponent move from side to side. And, you know, occasionally he would throw in a short slice just to make his opponent come forward and, you know, put him in an awkward position to hit an aggressive shot, and then probably the opponent would miss the shot, or then Federer would be in the middle of the court prepared to, you know, have a good shot at the open court. So that is a difference in his ground strokes, I would say. Other than that, you know, his serve, when it is working, it is perfect. So these are some of the things which he needs to work on, you know, 5-all, 6-all sets. More often than not, he should be on the winning side of these, so that, you know, it can help him in Grand Slams, because there is the stage, you know, where your confidence actually checks out against the other players. And apart from that, you know, his decision to play on clay or not to play on clay, I think it was not based on the result in Miami specifically. Maybe because he lost that final in Indian Wells, maybe he thought that, you know, it's too much tennis. He was physically tired as well as he was mentally tired, because, you know, he played a lot of tennis in the Australian Open, before that in Perth, and then again in Rotterdam. So I still think it was a lot of tennis that he played, and of course he achieved the goals that he intended to. He got the number one ranking and he got that Grand Slam title. So I think he was mentally a little bit tired, and he definitely needed rest. And because of his, you know, scheduling and Miami and Indian Wells being, you know, side by side, it was difficult for him to get that amount of rest that he required. So maybe because of that, he has chosen to give his body some time to recover, as well as, you know, get over these losses that he had recently, and as well as, you know, he doesn't want to take any chances prior to Wimbledon by playing on clay and, you know, stressing his body. So these are the reasons that he has, you know, definitely the reasons which have accounted for him, for his decision. But I still think, you know, since if you see Monte Carlo is starting on 15th April, then after, you know, you have Barcelona, and after that you have Madrid. So even if Federer would have, you know, wanted immediate rest, he still had that opportunity to take, you know, 1 month of rest. He would have skipped Monte Carlo, he would have skipped Barcelona, and he would directly have played Madrid or Rome, and then he could have played Roland Garros. So two tournaments on clay would have been, you know, good. But I am speaking that only in terms of, you know, if he wanted to win the French Open, as well as if he wanted to get the number one ranking back. And not only getting the number one ranking back, but if you have a long-term goal, if he wants to finish the year as number one, then definitely this is the time where he had to actually capitalize and, you know, gain those extra points. Because last year we saw, you know, Federer started well, Nadal started well at the French Open, and both were equally good, and it was just touch and go between both of them. And, you know, in the latter tournaments, Federer was actually left with too much to win in order to get that ranking. And as many tournaments as Nadal plays, Federer cannot play those many tournaments, because of the physique, the age thing, and, you know, even the freshness factor. I think Federer doesn't like to play each tournament. He likes to take appropriate rests in between, and the proof is, even in his peak years, he used to take some rest in between the tournaments. So I think that is definitely a thing. So if he wanted to, you know, he still has a lot of chances to finish the year as number one, because, you know, Nadal has to defend a lot of points on clay, but again, it leaves everything on Nadal's hands. If Federer would have, you know, actually was too much concerned about that ranking, then definitely he would have played on clay to gain at least 1,000 or, you know, 2,000 points, and then keep that cushion before going into Wimbledon, and you know thereafter he could have had a lot more chances, more easy chances, I would say. But even now, I think it's all up to Nadal. If he wins everything in clay, and you know Federer can win Wimbledon, again we'll be on even terms, and then US Open and the rest of the tournaments and the World Tour final will decide who finishes the year as number one. But looking at the decisions that Federer has made, it is obviously clear that at this point of time, he is not worried about the year-end number one ranking. He is only worried about the Wimbledon, that is, you know, his favorite Grand Slam tournament, as well as the rest he wants to take. Because if you see all the factors, definitely Federer has to take at least 2 or 3 weeks off at this moment, because he has played a lot of tennis already in this year. He has achieved almost all the goals that he intended to at the start of the year, and based on his losses, I think those have been tough for him physically, and he definitely requires a rest from that. But you know, when he says in his interviews that, you know, he needs to hit the practice court, he needs to take some time off, I think there should also be some time kept for this short analysis, which he should, you know, do to, in order to, you know, what can he actually do on big points to make sure that, you know, more often than not, he ends up on the winning side. Because, you know, these losses, although it's just 1 point, 1 or 2 points here and there, but you know, if it happens a lot of times, then it actually breaks down your confidence. And that has been the case for Federer against Nadal. On clay also, I think, you know, in all his matches at the beginning of his career, I think Federer played very well. And these were some few moments or few shots, few misses, which actually led to the breakdown of Federer's confidence. And, you know, thereafter, he was just out of confidence when he played Nadal on clay specifically. I mean, if before a match he's saying that Nadal is the favorite, and, you know, he is the greatest clay court player ever, which he is. But, you know, in the beginning of the match, if you are thinking that, you know, I don't have much chances, then definitely it means that, you know, you are lacking some confidence, that which you should not, because, you know, Federer is being considered as the greatest player of all time, and as the greatest ever, he shouldn't lose confidence, you know, against any player and at any surface. So I would think that, you know, gradually, if you lose too many matches, too many close matches, then it definitely breaks your confidence. And so Federer should try to avoid that, and he should, I would say, try to play a little safe in terms of ground strokes. Just as he used to play in his earlier years, in 2005 and 2006, if you look at all the break points and all the match points that he has played, it's not that, you know, every time he's going for a winner, it's not like that. But actually he's staying in a rally, changing directions on the ball, and, you know, playing a safe rally. This is what is missing, I think, from his game, at least in the last two tournaments, because he was actually panicking a lot, and he was not able to rally well. Now against Del Potro, it is understandable, because Del Potro puts a lot of pressure. But in that case, if you are able to change directions on the ball, then I think some of Del Potro's power is neutralized, which, you know, Nadal and Djokovic have been able to do against Del Potro. But against Federer, I think, you know, if he is not feeling well on his backhand, if he is not able to change directions from his backhand more often, then it actually leaves the open court for Del Potro, and he can just, you know, continue to hit a very aggressive forehand and, you know, wait for Federer to either miss or maybe hit, make an error. So that's the thing. I think, you know, it will be really important for Federer to figure out mentally how he needs to win these close matches. Of course, there is one person from whom everybody can learn. It's Nadal. You know, he never loses close matches, almost never. And it's not like he wins by hitting winners, or, you know, he wins by hitting aces or something. He just stays there, and that more often than not, you know, it is enough. If you stay there, it is enough for you to win. So that's what I think he needs to do. And of course, the rest that he'll be getting in the upcoming month or so, and the practice that he would be getting on, you know, practice courts, and, you know, he can regain his confidence, regain his movement, and definitely he'll be the favorite in Wimbledon, you know, regardless of whether he is ranked number one or number two, both of which he would, I think, take in with open arms, because I think in Wimbledon, regardless of the ranking, he'll definitely be a favorite wherever he, whenever he steps on court. So let's hope for, you know, his another Wimbledon title, and let's see what happens.